Shalom, today's Daf Yomi is Brachos Daf Mem Hey, Brachos 45. Today's Daf Yomi, we begin the seventh chapter of Brachos. This is the chapter called Shlosha She'achu, three that eat. And our Mishnah begins on Mem Hey Amid Aleph with the phrase Shlosha She'achu Ka'achas Chayavim Lazamin. Three people that eat together a meal are obligated to make a zimun. And Rashi says this means they're obligated to come together to bless Hashem in plural and say nivarech. This is what we call a zimun. And so the Gemara asks, what is the source for this? Menon Emili, how do we know that three people are required to come together to do a zimun, to call out together and bless God at the conclusion of the meal? So says Ravasi, this comes from the verse from Psalms 34:4, Gadlula Hashem iti, come give out, call praise to God with me, and we will exalt his name together. And this implies that one says to two people, Gadlu, in the plural, you call out the praise to a God with me, and so therefore there are three, and we're going to exalt his name together. Rabbi Avo says from here, from this verse, from Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 3, Ki Shem Hashem Ekra, the name of God I will call, Havu, go to Eloheinu, you give praise, give greatness to his name. And again, it's one person calls out on the name of God and the other two people are required to give praise. And in this context, the Gemara cites the position, Amar Rav Hanan bar Abba, minayin la'one amen. How do we know that when a person responds amen to a blessing that he hears from the from another person, that he shouldn't lift up his voice louder than the one who makes the blessing? And the reason for this is, as it states, Gadlu Hashem iti, give praise to God with me, and we'll exalt his name together. And the phrase Gadlu Hashem is again saying that's the answering of amen, but it needs to be with me, meaning to say that the one who responds amen, it needs to be the same level as the one who makes the blessing. That is the explanation of the Shita Mikubetzes. The Mishnah Berurah explains in Simen Kuf Chaf Dalet Sifka Mem Zayin that from this sugya we learn that it's the same thing with respect to Baruch Hu and also with the Zimun at the conclusion of the meal, and also with respect to Baruch Hu and the Zimun, a person should not lift up his voice more than the one who's making the blessing. However, he writes that if when a person lifts up his voice, it's his intent to inspire the people that they should also answer, then it would be permitted to do it. In this context, the Gemara says that Rabbi Shimon Pazi also taught Minayin She'ena Metargim. In those days, it used to be that there was somebody who would stand next to the Baal Kori, to the person reading the Torah, and he would translate all the verses into Aramaic so that the people would understand it. Today we don't do that anymore, but that was their practice, that after every verse a person would read one verse from the Torah and then the Metargim would come up and he would translate it. And the reason we don't do that today in Aramaic is because people don't understand the Aramaic anymore, so it's not going to be as much of a benefit. However, you know, it raises the question whether it should be more explanatory during the Torah reading. But going back to the Gemara says, "Minayin she'ena metargim rishai lagbia kol yoser menakori." How do we know that the person who is translating the Torah should not lift up his voice more than the one who's reading the Torah, but he should translate it in the same language? So the verse is, this is based upon the fact that the verse says, "Moshe yidaber," Moses spoke, "Ve'alokim yanenu b'kol," and God responded to him with a voice. And so we see from here that Moses was speaking and he would translate to the people that which he heard from God. And there's an extra word in this verse, because it says the extra word kol. Shein talma lomar b'kol. The verse does not need to say the word kol. It's extra. Ma talma lomar b'kol. Why does it say with the word b'kol? It's to teach us Bekol Shel Moshe, that it's with the sound of Moshe, that God answered Moshe with the same level of talking that Moshe was using as well. The Gemara cites a brisa to support this. Says the Gemara, "Eina metargim rishai lagbia kol yoser menakore," that the person who's a metargim is not able to lift up his voice greater than the one who is reading. "V'im efshar metargim lagbia kol," and if the So in this context, the Braise is saying that the one who's translating should not have his voice higher than the one who's reading the Torah. So if the one who's translating it is not able to raise his voice to the level of the one who's reading it, then says the Gemara, Yemayach HaKorek Kolo V'Yikra, then the person who's reading the Torah is supposed to lower his voice. And the Torah is the Torah, is the Word of God, and the translator is just translating. But we're seeing from here a very powerful idea that what is really the root of all this? The root of all this is that by answering a man in a louder voice or by doing the Targum in a louder voice than the Torah reading, you're it's almost like a level of arrogance. Look, I'm louder than this person. I'm ownership. I have ownership over it more. And that's there's this level of Yuarav, haughtiness associated with performance of the mitzvot. That's very, very troubling. And so even if the person who's a translator is unable to raise his voice to the level of the Torah reader, which is seemingly the source, is supposed to lower his voice so that it's not higher than the translator. And we learn this from God, that God responded to Moshe with the same level of the voice of Moshe. God lowered his voice to be like Moshe, so too we should lower our voices so that they are equal to the level of the person who is responding amen or translating the Torah.